Okay, well, let's start. First of all, let me introduce myself. I'm Steven Bloemendaal. I'm an exploration geologist. I studied a long time ago at the University of Amsterdam. And after my studies, I went to work for Shell Oil Company. I've worked for 35 years for Shell Oil Company. And 4 years ago, I started my own consulting business. What I do, I help exploration companies with their decisions about prospects and plays. I do give training. I do this consulting, and I also develop software to help make those exploration decisions easier. And in this webinar, we are going to look at one of the products. It's Prospector Lite. And so I think this whole webinar will take about 45 minutes of your time. I'd like to start here. So I've got a little agenda. First of all, an introduction in exploration volume calculation, just a general introduction, how the calculation is done. Area depths method to calculate gross rock volumes. That is a method this tool applies to calculate the gross rock volume. Then I'll talk a bit about deterministic volumes, probabilistic volumes, and pseudo-probabilistic volumes, and what the differences are in how you calculate those. I'll have a look at Prospector Lite. That is, you see this image, that's an image of the tool we are going to use in this webinar. A bit of a question, how good are pseudo-probabilistic volumes? This tool calculates pseudo-probabilistic volumes, so I'll show you a bit how good those volumes are, how they compare with probabilistic volumes, and then I'd like to wrap up. This software is freeware, and you can download it at the site here at the bottom of of this slide. So if you go there, you can download it and you can use it as you like. So the introduction of the volume equation. The volume equation is really a very simple equation. What we do, we start with a gross rock volume. In this case, I indicate it as a cube of rock, which is just the volume of a rock. And the next step is to separate that volume, the rock volume, from reservoir to non-reservoirs. So you have to separate, well, this is reservoir and this is non-reservoir. The next step is to define the pore volumes, because the reservoir consists of a lot of rock, but we are not as interested really in the rock, we are interested in the pore space between those grains. So you have to kind of define how much pore volume is in this reservoir volume. The next step is how much hydrocarbons is in this pore volume, because the pore volume will initially be water bearing. When a trap fills with hydrocarbons, it will displace the water, but it won't displace all the water. So there will always be some water in the pore volume. So you have to kind of define how much hydrocarbons is in this pore volume. Once you've calculated the hydrocarbons in the pore volume, that is hydrocarbon volumes in subsurface conditions. And when you produce that, you have to bring that to the surface. So you have to translate those subsurface volumes into surface volumes. And for that, oil will shrink because the temperature effect and the degassing of the oil. So there's a shrinkage factor for oil. And gas will expand because of the pressure effect. High pressure below and lower pressures at surface. And the final step is you have to define the recovery factor, because you won't be able to recover all that oil in the pore space or all the gas in the pore space. You always leave stuff behind. So there's a recovery factor. So the volume equation, if you look at the numbers you need a number for a gross rock volume, an estimate for a gross rock volume. You need an estimate for a net over gross to separate the gross rock volume in reservoir volume and non-reservoir volume. You need the estimate of a porosity to go from reservoir volume into pore volume. You need an estimate for saturation to define how much hydrocarbons are in that pore volume. You need the estimate of a volume factor to define how much, by how much will the oil shrink or the gas expand. And then you need an estimate for a recovery factor. And you see it's a very simple equation. And so in that sense, a simple tool should be able to do that for you. And I think Prospector Lite is one of those tools which can multiply those few numbers for you. So let's go to the gross rock volume. That is one of the challenges in this equation. How do you calculate gross rock volume? And This slide is about how we calculate gross rock volumes, and this tool uses the area depth method. And that is the area depth method, that's a 2D representation of area plotted versus depth of a 3D geological structure. And that's used to estimate the gross rock volume. So here we've got the map, an example of a little map. The crest is here. These are different contours, and there's a fault here. So it's a fault bounded high. And we have to translate it into an area depth graph. How that works is at the crest, at zero, there's zero area enclosed in that contour. So you start at the crest at zero. So this is the depth scale and this is the area scale. At the depth Z1, there's a certain amount of enclosed area at Z1. So that is here. That's the area at Z1. So the next one, the contour Z2, there's a larger area enclosed in that, within that contour. Note that what is enclosed in this contour, it's inclusive of this area. Do not subtract it. You use the whole area at Z2. And so on and so on. So this curve, it's always increasing, and that's depth and that's area. The cute thing of this graph is this is area. So these are two dimensions and the depth is one dimension. So what happens in this graph, areas in this graph represent a volume, because you multiply two dimensions with one dimension and that's a volume. So if you've got the top reservoir and if you also project the base reservoir, the same thing, area depth curve, you can do that projection by putting the reservoir thickness, hang the reservoir thickness below the top, and that is then a true vertical reservoir thickness, which you hang below the top. And then you've got the base reservoir, the top reservoir. And so this is a volume. The only thing we still need to know, well, where is the contact? So if this is the contact where we believe the contact is, we put that contact here, the hydrocarbon water contact, and then this area on this graph, that is a gross rock volume. So this is a rather simple way to calculate gross rock volume from a structural map. So note that the area depth graph, it's not a geological cross section. These are two dimensions. This is two dimensional, this is one dimensional. Of course, in a geological cross section, this is a one dimensional, that's a one dimensional. So you should not confuse those things for a cross section. They look like a cross sections, but they're not. A bit about deterministic, probabilistic, and pseudo probabilistic volumes. So now we know how to calculate the gross rock volume. You need to estimate the net of a gross porosity saturation volume factor and recovery factor. So a deterministic volume, you just multiply those numbers. So you multiply the gross rock volume times the net of a gross times the porosity times the saturation times the volume factor times the recovery factor. And if you multiply those numbers, you get the deterministic volume. Probabilistic volumes, what you do, instead of having single numbers for those input parameters, you have uncertainty distributions for the input parameters. So you create an uncertainty distribution for the gross rock volume, for the net of a gross porosity, etc. And what probabilistic volumes does, it takes, in general, it uses the Monte Carlo process to calculate those volumes. What it does, it samples each distribution, takes a random sample of each distribution and makes a deterministic volume calculation of the samples. So you get one deterministic volume of a Monte Carlo sample. And then you take another sample, a random sample, and you make a deterministic calculation of that sample. And so if you do that many times, say 10,000 times, you get 10,000 samples of those distributions and 10,000 deterministic volumes of those samples. And so those volumes will be another distribution, and that will be the uncertainty distribution of the volumes, or that will be the probabilistic volumes. So it's probabilistic volumes is really very simple. So you need uncertainty distribution as inputs. You need a deterministic calculator to calculate those outputs, and then you get the probabilistic volume out of it. Now let's go to pseudo-probabilistic volumes. Pseudo-probabilistic volume, it makes a deterministic volume calculation, like this calculation, and it multiplies that with an uncertainty. So you have a deterministic volume, and then you ask yourself, well, what is the uncertainty of this distribution? And you multiply it with that uncertainty, and then you get a pseudo-probabilistic volume. So in this case, you have one number as an output. In this case, you have an uncertainty distribution as an output. In this case, you get also uncertainty distribution as an output because you multiply it with an uncertainty. But the method is quite a lot simpler than this one because you only need to estimate one uncertainty distribution instead of you need to estimate all the uncertainty distributions. Prospector Light, the tool we are going to look at, that makes deterministic volume calculations and it will make pseudo-probabilistic volume calculations. So the deterministic volume calculation is just to, if you fill in those numbers, so numbers for the gross rock volume, net of gross sickness, etc., and you get a deterministic answer. Pseudo-probabilistic volumes, you add that uncertainty and you get a pseudo-probabilistic answer. Another thing is, in order to calculate the gross rock volume, you can digitize for the area depth method. And there's another thing, you can risk merge multiple objectives in this tool, but in this webinar, I'm not going to talk about that utility. Yeah? That's for another time. So I want to do a short demo now of how that works. This is a little prospect mock-up. This is actually an example I use in one of my classes. And so I want to calculate the volumes for this one. So this is the volume calculator, the Prospect Light that you can download. The first challenge now will be how to get this data into the tool. So that's the area depth data. So there are two ways of doing that. One is to import a table. Unfortunately, we don't have the table, but we have a map. So I want to import and digitize it. So what we have to do now for that, I'll have to grab an image. Let me get a snippet tool working. So here's a snippet tool. So what I do, I grab an image of the map. So now I've got the image in the snippet tool. I say copy of that image. And I go to here to the tool, I say import digitize, and here I say paste. So now I've got this map into the tool. And so what I can, let's make it slightly bigger so it's easier to see. So now we have to, first of all, we have to define the scale bar. Yeah. There's a scale bar here, so I say this. So it starts from here. So that's 1 kilometer, 2 kilometer, 3 kilometer, 4 kilometer, 5 kilometer. In general, it's best to make your scale bar when you digitize as large as possible. That increases the accuracy of your digitization. So now this scale bar we have defined is 5 kilometers. The next step is define your crest. So our crest is at, let's say, make it 2,520, something like that. Now we going to digitize the 2600 contour. So 2600, so you digitize it. So now you see at 2600 we've got 0.38 square kilometers. Here you can kind of define if you want it in square kilometers or I use square kilometers in general, but you can put it in different units. So now we go to 2700 and I will digitize 2700. And there we've got 1.47 square kilometers. So 2800. 2.8 square kilometers, 2900. For and 3000. 3000 is beyond the spill point. I mean, the spill point of the closures here. But we had, let's make one contour which is slightly deeper than that, and we cut it off as the contact. So this is 3000. Yeah, and that's 7.2. So now we've got this map digitized and we say save. Now we've got the same data here in the tool. So now we've got here an area depth curve of this prospect. Let's get rid of this one. And now we just have to fill in the different properties. Well, first of all, there's 100 meters of sand. So let's make it 100 meters thickness. And so now we've got here the top reservoir and the base reservoir in the graph. Now the question becomes, where do we put the spill, where do we put the contact? And what you have to do into this tool, you have to put the deepest possible contact, and that would be, that is easy to find always, that is very well defined. So that's say 2920. And so now we've got the contact here. So here we've got the gross rock volume down to the deepest possible contact. But you also have to define what is the mean oil water contact. By the way, you can fill it with oil, with gas, or with oil and gas. You can also have a gas oil contact. But anyway, this is an oil prospect, so I've got the oil only option here. So now the question is, where is the mean contact? If so, there's a contact uncertainty here, and what is the mean contact there? In general, as a first approach, I recommend to make the mean contact kind of half full. So let's make it 2720. Let's say that. Let's now look at the columns. So the mean column is 200 meters and the maximum column is 400 meters. So now the trap is the mean column is half full and the maximum is 400. This is just a recommendation of mine to make it half full. If you know nothing better, then just make the maximum column down to the deepest spill point and the mean column make it half full. So now we've got a gross rock volume here calculated. We've got a thickness, so we have to multiply those numbers. So let's assume that the net of a gross is 1. It is just all sand. The porosity is 0.2. The saturation is 0.75. The BOI is 1.1, the volume factor. Now a GOR. A GOR is not given here, but let's make one. Here you see, by the way, the GOR at the moment, the units are in meters, cubic meters over cubic meters. It is more a metric convention. In general, we use in barrels and feet. So here you can use the units at the top. Just use that unit. And now we've got here standard cubic feet per barrel. So let's make that 500 standard cubic feet per barrel. So oil recovery factor is 0.3, it's defined there, and gas recovery factor is also 0.3. So what we've got now, we've got the gross rock volume defined by an area depth curve. Here's a graph of it, and here we've got all those input parameters, so now we do have the volumes. And that's what you see here. Here you see the deterministic in-place volumes at the mean contact and at the deepest possible contact. So at the mean contact, we've got about 100 million barrels in place. And at the deepest contact, we've got about 330 million barrels in place. If you now go to the recoverable volumes is 30 million barrels at the mean contact and 100 million barrels at the deepest possible contact. So this is the deterministic answer. Now we want to make pseudo-probabilistic voids. And so that for that we have to define an uncertainty range. The uncertainty range is defined by a P10P90 ratio. So I've got here a P10P90 ratio guide. So you click on that and what you get here, and you've got a certain amount of questions you have to answer of how much do you know about this prospect? So how uncertain are those input parameters? So the hydrocarbon column, I would say there's a large uncertainty because we really know very little about it. It's just a slide we've got. The hydrocarbon phase, it is given here that it's an oil prospect. So let's assume that, okay, we can make it a calibrated beta model or a direct observation. That is just, so there's no uncertainty there. Reservoir thickness, we correlated with this well. So there's a correlation with a well which is nearby. So that the uncertainty is based on that then. The net over gross, there's also correlation with a well. The porosity, there's a correlation with a well. Saturation, let's say that's local trends. Hydrocarbon properties, maybe local trends. And recovery factor, local trends. So now we've got here a measure of the uncertainties we've got for those input parameters. And based on those uncertainties, here's a suggested P10P90 range of the output. So on the low side, it's 15, the mid side is 20, and the high side is 28. So here we've got an indication how uncertain the volumes are. So now we've got that done, and so let's make this 20 as a base case. So now the uncertainty is 20, and now we've got here the pseudo-probabilistic volumes. So you see for the deterministic volumes here above, we saw the deterministic volume at the mean contact was 30 million barrels. If you go to the pseudo-probabilistic volumes for the liquids, it's 33 million barrels, where the P90 is 3.7, the P50 is 18, and the P10 is 83. And that has got the P10-P90 ratio of 20. And that's the number we defined as being the uncertainty. So now we've got the thing evaluated. So you see, it doesn't take a lot of time. I think we've been busy for 5 minutes or so to do this. And so now we've got the volume. I want to save it. So let's create a database, a new project database. Let's call that webinar. Okay, you do not want to raise it. So now let's call this prospect whatever, Friday morning. So now I've got the Friday morning prospect saved in this beta database. A bit on this bar at the top, this bar, this has got a lot of little utility. So here, this thing, you can erase the evaluation. So if I erase it, it is gone. Now I've got it saved in the database. So if I load it up, it comes back. Here you can save it. Here you can delete it from the database. Another thing I like to mention is useful. If you, this one, it, there you can find the manual for the tool and also the website and some version data on the tool, etc. So, but if you use the tool, I recommend you to look at the manual. Another useful thing is a copy and paste button. So if I put on the copy, this copies the evaluation and puts it in the clipboard. So now the evaluation is in the clipboard. And what I can do now, I can paste that in an email and send it to somebody I want to share this evaluation with. Or what I'm doing now, I'm pasting it in the chat box. So now you have this evaluation in the chat box. And so if I clear it now, it's erased. If you grab it now from the chat box and you put it in your clipboard and you paste it, and then you paste it from your clipboard into the tool. So now at this moment, everybody who's on this meeting can have this evaluation on their own machine. Yeah? So I found it a very useful method of sharing information, sharing your insight with others. If you want to do a more comprehensive probabilistic evaluation, I have another tool. This is called Prospector Lite, but there's also a tool called Prospector, which does the full probabilistic analysis of a prospect. You can also copy this evaluation and paste it into the Prospector tool for a further analysis of it. So let's continue. A bit, how good are pseudo-probabilistic volumes versus probabilistic volumes? On the x-axis here are pseudo-probabilistics, the mean of the pseudo-probabilistic volumes. On the y-axis are the mean of probabilistic volumes using the Prospector tool. These are real prospects. These are not synthetic prospects. This is real data, and it's about 2,000 different prospects. I did evaluation in both tools. And this is how it correlates. So you see, it correlates pretty well. I mean, it more or less gives the same answer. If you look at the uncertainty around it, this is a graph of the delta of probabilistic minus probabilistic in percentage. Yeah. So 0% is here. So that's where it should be. And you see that the difference is less than about 10%. This would be a P85 and a P95 of the difference. So standard, let's call it a standard deviation. And so it's less than 10% accurate. So if Prospector Lite gives you a number of 100, then probably full probabilistic volumes, the answer will be between 110 and 90. You will get more or less the same answer. A wrap up. Well, something I didn't talk about, but which is very important to realize always, understanding the Bayesian and play context is essential for quantitative prospect evaluation. Now we did a prospect in isolation. We knew nothing. It was just a slide and we knew nothing about it. That is not the way to do it, really. You need to understand your Bayesian and play before you can do and even think about doing a prospect assessment. Or a quantitative prospect assessment. So this is an essential step. Always make sure you understand your Bayesian and play before you work on a quantitative prospect assessment. Prospector Lite can help you get an accurate volume estimate for screening purposes. The answers are accurate, and I say it's good for screening purposes. I mean, now we looked at the prospect. You've got a map, and you think, well, hey, how much do you think can be there? And you see, in 5 minutes, you will have an answer. Pseudo-probabilistic volumes are a good approximation of probabilistic volumes, so you get all pretty good answer of the uncertainty around the prospect. And there's another tool. I've got Prospector, that's a full probabilistic application, which can be used for a comprehensive prospect analysis. The next week webinar, I will do an exercise with Prospector, then you can see that how that works and how that compares with Prospector Lite. So final slide, we offer a 3-day course in quantitative prospect evaluation. That course goes into details of all the quantifications of what you need to know to come to prospect evaluation. Several people actually contact me now, well, can't you do this on a webinar? And some parts I can do in a webinar, but really there are a lot of hands-on exercises which are better done in a classroom. So I will try to do just bits and pieces in webinars, but for more stuff, you will have to come to a class. We also offer a 3 or 5 day course on prospect evaluation in a play context, where we go through this whole building the foundation prospect. This definitely is a very hand-on class, and so that definitely doesn't fit in a webinar. You can download this freeware there. You can contact me, and please, I'm all open for your comments and suggestions, and I like to hear from you. And then, any questions?